as I'm sure you just saw from the title of this page, today's episode is going to be based on the Middle Ages, otherwise known as the medieval period. As always, we've got our sources prepped and good to go. I thought I'd try and give a little more structure to this episode, as the information being provided to us now is in some cases overwhelming, and there are also a few topics that I was quite keen to touch on, but we'll still venture into different areas as and when we need to. And fortunately, we're able to use history. Impression of what the period may have looked like, but perhaps we'll find some on the way. For now, though, let's delve into the world of Middle Age Europe. Scientific accomplishment. size of Islam. The Crusades is something we'll certainly be coming on to first, but I think first of all I'd like to give my own opinion on where I see the start of the Middle Ages, or at least how I separate the Dark Ages from the medieval period. And the line that I draw is right here at the Battle of Hastings. You'll note that a lot of the pages and the history of this period will be battles, but I will try and move on to more passive subjects as the episode goes on. Now, the Battle of Hastings, you may think that this is a somewhat biased opinion because this was a big battle, but only really if you are an Englishman, which I am. So for me, this is quite a monumental period in my country's history, as you'll find out in just a moment. So, on October the 14th, 1066, at the Battle of Hastings in England, King Harold II of England was defeated by the Norman forces of William the Conqueror. By the end of the bloody all-day battle, Harold was dead and his forces were destroyed. He was the last Anglo-Saxon king of England, as the battle changed the course of history and established the Normans as the rulers of England, which in turn brought about significant cultural transformation. So there are a couple of key points to take from this battle. Something that most English people look at, particularly when you talk about wars such as the First and Second World War, Just over 2 weeks before the Battle of Hastings in October 1066, William had invaded England, claiming his right to the English throne. In 1051, William is believed to have visited England and met with his cousin Edward the Confessor. The childless English king. Historians, Edward promised to make William his heir. On his deathbed, however, Edward granted the kingdom to Harold Godwinson, head of the leading noble family in England and more powerful than the king himself. In January 1066, King Edward died and Harold Godwinson was second. William immediately disputed his claim. Lovely. So here we have an idea of the battle. Now, it happened in 1066, and from what I recall, King Harold II not only had to deal with William the Conqueror, but he also perhaps only a week or so before had to fight an invading army of Norwegian or Norsemen led by King Harald Hardrada. At least that is the history that I know. In any case, when the Battle of Hastings took place in, of course, Hastings, William, first of all, landed in England and seized Pevensey on the south coast. Once he marched to Hastings, Harold arrived near Hastings with his army the next day, and on October the 14th, William led his forces out to battle, which ended in a decisive victory against Harold's men. Harold was killed, shot in the eye with an arrow, according to legend, and his forces were destroyed. And there's a famous tapestry of the Battle of Hastings where you can see a man with an arrow in his eye. I wonder if that is signifying King Harold II. Anyway, after his victory at the Battle of Hastings, William marched on London and received the city's submission. On Christmas Day of 1066, he was crowned the first Norman King of England in Westminster Abbey, and the Anglo-Saxon phase of English history came to an end. French became the language of the king's court and gradually blended with Anglo-Saxon tongue to give birth to modern English. Illiterate, like most nobles of his time, William spoke no English whatsoever. ascended the throne and failed to master it despite his efforts. Thanks to the Norman invasion, French was spoken in England's courts for centuries and completely transformed the English language, infusing it with new words. William the First proved an effective king of England, and the Domesday Book, a great census of the lands and people of England, was among his notable achievements. And the Domesday Book is a famous book, which, as it says, it was a census. It was almost like a catalogue. It was it chronicled the areas, the lands, the towns, the villages. And a lot, I believe it also included names, which was incredible. I think the real the main factor that's so impressive about the Domesday Book is that, considering before this time, again, we still considered England to be part of a dark age, although it had a unified king. It's all, the nobles are always the nobles, and you can always trace their lineage, and people know what's going on in the upper classes of royalty. But we don't really have a lot of information on the common folk, the people that lived in the villages, the people that farmed, the people, the blacksmiths, the grocers, the everyday people who were just getting by their lives. And this book helped to give a bit of an idea, a bit more notice to those regular folk. Hastings, as interesting as it is very England central. So let's move into a more European aspect, a European view of the Middle Ages. Something I did find quite interesting as well. I suppose that's a bit later on, but perhaps we'll come back to that. We've got a couple of maps here that we can look at, and some more in a moment. Okay. So I suppose the next thing we really want to be looking at in terms of chronological order is the Crusades. Now, as mentioned up here, and as mentioned in one of the previous Dark Ages episode, one of the unifying factors of Europe at the time of the Middle Ages, and I suppose also the Dark Ages, was that although there was no unifying empire, once the Roman Empire had gone, there was a unifying religion. And for much of Western Europe, that religion was the Catholic Church of Rome. And even though that was just Western Europe, the whole of Europe was at least, in most cases, Christian, if not Catholic, then Orthodox Christian as a majority, with likely other pagan religions and perhaps Judaism in places, and Islam in areas of some of the islands and in southern Spain. But for large parts of Europe, pretty much all nations were now under one banner, Christianity. Now, toward the end of the 11th century, the Catholic Church began to authorize military expeditions Crusades began in 1095 when Pope Urban summoned a Christian army to fight its way to Jerusalem and continued on and off until the end of the 15th century. In 1099, Christian armies captured Jerusalem from Muslim Western Europe started visiting the Holy Land. Many of them, however, were robbed and killed as they crossed through Muslim-controlled territories during their journey. Around 1118, a French knight named Hugus de Payen created a military order along with eight relatives and acquaintances that became the Knights Templar, and they won the eventual support of the Pope and a reputation for being fearsome fighters. The fall of Acre in 1291 marked the destruction of the last remaining Crusader refuge in the Holy Land, and Pope Clement V dissolved the Knights Templar in 1312. No one won the Crusades. In fact, many thousands of people from both sides lost their lives. They did make ordinary Catholics across Christendom feel like they had a common purpose, and they inspired waves of religious enthusiasm among people who might otherwise have felt alienated from the official church. They also exposed Crusaders to Islamic literature, science, and technology, exposure that would have a lasting effect on European intellectual life. That last point being very interesting because, as we mentioned in our last episode, Dark Ages episode, how while Europe's scientific improvements were increasing steadily, if not stagnating, the Islamic world was flourishing with the help of translations from ancient Roman and Greek texts. So, it's interesting to know that the Crusades did have positive outcomes for Europe. Let's have a little bit of a deeper look at the Crusades. Here we go. So, by the end of the 11th century, Western Europe had emerged as a significant power in its own right, though it still lagged behind other Mediterranean civilizations, such as that of the Byzantine Empire, formerly the eastern half of the Roman Empire, and the Islamic Empire of the Middle East and North Africa. However, Byzantium had lost considerable territory to the invading Seljuk Turks, and after years of chaos and civil war, the general Alexius Comnenus seized the Byzantine throne in 1081 and consolidated control over the remaining Francis sent envoys to Pope Urban II, asking for mercenary troops from the west to help confront the Turkish threat. Though relations between Christians in the east and west had long been fractious, Alexis's request came at a time when the situation was improving. And in November 1095, at the Council of Clermont in southern France, the Pope called on Western Christians to take up arms to aid the Byzantines and recapture the Holy Land from Muslim control. This marked the beginning of the Crusades. Okay, so we hear about some of the orders. Now we've heard about the Knights Templar, but there were other groups such as the Teutonic Knights and the Hospitaller Knights. The Knights Templar, although originally being set up with a positive goal in mind, they, as we heard, were dissolved by the Pope a couple of centuries later, and that was after reports of them becoming more than they had originally intended. Their order changed from being an order of knights helping pilgrims get to the Holy Land to an order of knights who became bloodthirsty and crave blood, even if it was from innocent Islamic citizens. I don't know too much about the Teutonic Order, but the Hospitallers are an interesting one. As you may notice from the name, they were of the Order of St. John, and St. John is the patron saint of doctors, I believe. I think. Let's just see if we can find that. So St. John was canonized by Pope Alexander VIII and later renamed the patron saint of hospitals and the sick. But he was known before this day as a figure for this sort of aspect. Assistance helping the weak and frail. And that's why we see a lot of, particularly in the UK, we see St. John's Ambulance being the ambulance service that, you know, helps so many people every day. And part of this stemmed from the order Hospital. There's probably a real set of meanings behind that, but I don't really know it too well. So if you did perhaps know the truth behind that, I may be just ranting a little bit, but I think there is some sort of connection, but please feel free to leave a comment or research it. I think we'll carry on for now, as we may run out of time. Now this unfortunately is one of the grimmer stories of the Crusade, so So as you can see, we have many different battles. We have the First Crusade. Where the Christians came in and took the city of Jerusalem. This was in 1097. Captured the besieged city of Jerusalem, the end goal of Christianity's crusades, the holy city, the city where Jesus Christ was put to death on the cross. But, and as I'm sure recent news articles and news stories have shown, it's not just a city that's holy to Christians, it's holy to Islamic. Islamic king in the south by the name of Saladin, although this may not quite have been the same time, but I'm sure we'll read a little bit more about that in just a moment. News of Edessa's fall stunned Europe and caused the Christian authorities in the west to call for another crusade led by two great rulers, King Louis
Essentially, after this period, it's the Third Crusade was the last real true crusade. The Fourth Crusade was more of a desperate effort, and it was actually used to try and topple the Byzantine Emperor Alexis III. So they, instead of
Tunisia, maybe bits of Algeria, the dominion of Saladin, and if we really zoom in, I suppose, I wonder if we can zoom in any further, you can see that some of the Crusader kingdoms are still here, the principality. Some other very interesting bits here as well. We've got England, Scotland and Wales, of course, still separate in their own nations at this point. Or truly separated anyway, not unified under the United Kingdom of Great Britain quite yet. And of course, you have a lot of the smaller islands in orange because the Kingdom of Norway controlled all of these smaller of land. But as you may be able to see here, you've got a red, a pinkish outline around some of France. Now, although the Kingdom of France was this area here, much of what we know is today being France, this area. It's going back to English history, but it's, you know, it's a topic that I have a bit knowledge about, and but you know, still happy to learn a bit more about as well. So let's get a brief overview of the Hundred Years' War, I think. So the name, the Hundred Years' War, has been used by historians since the beginning of the 19th century. Describe the long conflict that pitted the kingdoms of France and England against each other from 1337 to 1453. So in fact it's a bit longer than 100, it's 116 years. Two factors lay at the origin of the conflict. First, the status of the duchy of Guienne or Aquitaine, though it belonged of England, it remained a fief of the French crown, and the kings of England wanted independent possession. Second, as the closest relatives of the last direct Capetian king, Charles IV, who died in 1328, the kings of England from 1337 claimed the crown of France. Interesting. That was the case. Theoretically, the French kings possessing the financial and military resources of the most popular
1360, King John of France, in order to save his title, was forced to accept the Treaty of Calais, which granted complete independence of the Duchy of Guienne, now considerably enlarged to include almost a third of France. However, his son Charles V, with the help of his commander-in-chief Bertrand de Guesclin, that's a mouthful, I'm not sure how that's pronounced. His commander-in-chief Bertrand, by 1380, had succeeded in reconquering almost all the ceded territory, notably by a series of sieges. After a hiatus, Henry V of England renewed the war and proved victorious at Agincourt and conquered Normandy, and then attempted to have himself crowned as the future King of France by the Treaty of Troyes. But his military successes were not matched by political successes. Although allied with the Dukes of Burgundy, the majority of the French refused English domination. Thanks to Joan of Arc, the siege of Orléans was lifted in 1429. Then Paris and the Île-de-France was liberated, and after the French army had been reorganized and reformed, Charles VII recaptured the Duchy of Normandy and then seized Guyenne, the region of Aquitaine. The end of the conflict was never marked by a peace treaty, but died out because the English recognized that the French troops were too strong to be directly confronted. English territory in France, which had been extensive since 1066, now remained confined to the Channel port of Calais. France, at last free of English invaders, resumed its place as the dominant state of Western Europe. So, there are a couple of big points with the Hundred Years' War. I think the one from the English point of view is the Battle of Agincourt, which is a truly incredible battle. It goes down as one of the most incredible victories on a battlefield. For the English, I think it's probably the most incredible victory, and certainly one of the most incredible for any nation of all time. And I'd like to just go through a little bit on that now, and then we'll have a little look at Joan of Arc from a French perspective, someone who it was equally incredible, but in a more spiritual and holy sort of way. So we'll have a look at her in just a moment. So, during the Hundred Years' War between England and France, Henry V, the young King of England, leads his forces to victory at the Battle of Agincourt in Norman France. So you have it, so Henry V, the King of England, and this is the same king who we read about a moment ago. So 2 months before, Henry had crossed over the English Channel with 11,000 men and lay siege to Harfleur in Normandy. So we've got a map here, and we sort of zoom in a little bit. You can imagine that the English would come over from Dover to Calais. I believe Normandy is this section here, yep, Brittany. I believe this is Normandy, around this sort of area. And this is the Duchy of Aquitaine, or Guienne, as they were talking about before, which belongs to England. Although this map's it's 1360, so. And this. Around the same time, isn't it? That's 1412. Maybe it's
it's just after. I'm not sure. Anyway, so you can imagine. Agincourt, however, a vast French army of 20,000 men stood in his path, greatly outnumbering the exhausted English archers, knights, and men-at-arms. Now bear in mind, he came over with 11,000 men, and he lost half his men, so let's say, at best case, he's at least about 6,000 troops left. And Henry V has now been confronted by an army of 20,000 French. The battlefield lay on 1,000 yards of open ground between two woods, which prevented large-scale manoeuvres and thus worked to Henry's advantage. At 11 a.m. on October 25th, the battle commenced. The English stood their ground as French knights, weighed down by their heavy armour, began a slow advance across the muddy battlefield. The French were met by a furious bombardment of artillery from the English archers, who wielded innovative longbows with a range of 250 yards. French cavalrymen tried and failed to overwhelm the English positions, but the archers were protected by a line of pointed stakes as more and more French knights made their way onto the crowded battlefield. Their mobility decreased further, and some lacked even the room to raise their arms to strike a blow. At this point, Henry ordered his lightly equipped archers to rush forward with swords and axes, and the unencumbered Englishmen massacred the French. Almost 6,000 Frenchmen lost their lives during the Battle of Agincourt, while English deaths amounted to just over 400. With odds greater than 3-1, Henry had won one of the great victories of military history. After further conquests in France, Henry V was recognized in 1420 as heir to the French throne and the regent of France. He was at the height of his powers, but died just 2 years later of camp fever near Paris. And it's, you know, it's really an incredible victory when you think about it. Oh. Just, you know, how they managed to do this was something else. So, I don't know, I was thinking perhaps I'll just draw something here. So we've got, let's make that a little bit more elongated. So we have, first of all, the French army over here. I'll make them these lines here. Oh, didn't like that, did it? These French lines, and we have to remember there's a lot of them. The English in red are over here. Okay, so there's just, you know, three banks of them here, not too many. But the French, you know, loads and loads of them. Now, as I mentioned, we've got lots of woodland here, and much more woodland here. Excuse the awful diagram, but it's just to give you a bit of an idea. And then in the middle we have a muddy ground. Okay. Uh,
largest, if not powerful, countries in Western Europe. They had Charlemagne, their leader, 500 years earlier, set up the Kingdom of the Franks. And they were still a very powerful and respectable nation. So their knights would have been well armed, well equipped, and if anything, perhaps overly equipped, too heavy. The trees either side would have meant that cavalry, knights on horseback, would not have been able to really get round the central walkway, the central battlefield. They'd have to traverse quite some way, and if they did, they'd be met by stakes that the horses just would not be able to get over. So it was either they did that, which wasted time, or they went through the middle. And as they mentioned, these longbows, which were an innovation for warfare at the time in Europe, could fire so far that even as the knights started to walk midway through this battlefield, they were pelted by arrows. And it's and if you think about it, these heavy, clunky, armoured knights, some of them falling in battle, some getting stuck, you know, you're stuck in the mud, you can't go any further because there's a comrade of yours who's on the floor, and you can't climb over him because you're sinking into it. And by the time that, you know, half of the French force had gone, this was just a mess of bodies and mud and blood. And for those in heavy armour, the manoeuvrability aspect is just, it's almost impossible. And it really was a masterstroke, considering how, absolutely shattered this army was from its previous campaign, and how many of its number had been lost. To win against such a vast number of French was, and to have received only so few casualties, really was a stroke of genius. Anyway, let's leave my particularly poor paint, and I think we'll move on now to Joanne of Arc. So Joanne of Arc, a peasant girl living in medieval France, believed that God had chosen her to lead France to victory in its long-running war with England. With no military training, Joanne, or Joan, convinced the embattled Crown Prince Charles of Valois to allow her to lead a French army to the besieged city of Orleans, where it achieved a momentous victory over the English and their French allies, the Burgundians. After seeing the prince crowned King Charles VII, Joan, was captured by the Anglo-Burgundian forces, tried for witchcraft and heresy, and burned at the stake in 1431. At the age of just 19 years old. By the time she was officially canonized in 1920, the Maid of Orleans, as she was known, had long been considered one of history's great saints, an enduring symbol of French unity and nationalism. Now it's, I think there is quite a lot of information on this page. We probably won't read through all of it, but perhaps we'll come back to this a little bit at the end here. The story behind Joan of Arc is, it really is incredible. This, if you think about how Western Europe in, the 13th century? 13th century Western Europe was almost entirely ruled by male nobility. And so, you know, being a female and being a peasant, you were, unfortunately at the time, the lowest of the low. You weren't, your outlook on life was particularly grim. But the fact that this, as it mentions here, this peasant
certainly into doing their bit. She was the son. Stories how Henry the Sixth did not manage to hold his claim over France. So there's some incredible storytelling here. So at the age of 13, Joan began to hear voices, which she determined had been sent by God to give her a mission of overwhelming importance to save France by expelling its enemies. Charles as its rightful king. As part of this divine mission, Joan took a vow of chastity, and at the age of 16, after her father attempted to arrange a marriage for her, she successfully convinced the local court that she should not be forced to accept the match. It's incredible, isn't it? Now, you know, back then, or in nowadays, we would look at that and think, hearing voices, perhaps, you know, it's perhaps there's something else going on there, some sort of mental health issue, and, you know, perhaps there was at the time. I wouldn't say I'm particularly religious, but I'm not, you know, I'm in no position to tell people what they believe in is wrong. So, you know, it's just interesting, though, that if this had been a modern day thing, this would have been looked at in a very different way. But, you know, 600-700 years ago, a young girl hearing voices in her head goes on to save France. It's almost poetic for this very religious and very pious part of the world. Yeah, so some of the sieges she broke, the downfall. Okay, so. So after taking Orléans, so they wanted to try and press the advantage by the look of it. She argued the French pressed their advantage with an attempt to retake Paris. But Charles wavered, even as his favourites at court. Georges de la Tremoille warned him that Joan was becoming too powerful. The Anglo-Burgundians were able to fortify their positions in Paris and turned back an attack led by Joan in September, and in the spring of 1430, the king ordered Joan to confront a Burgundian assault of Compiègne. In her efforts to defend the town and its inhabitants, she was thrown from her horse and left outside the town's gates as they closed. The Burgundians took her captive and brought her amid much fanfare to the castle of Bouffrail. Occupied by the English commander at Rouen. And then she was, of course, burnt at the stake. In the trial that followed, Joan was ordered to answer to some 70 charges against her, including witchcraft, heresy, and dressing like a man. The Anglo-Burgundians were aiming to get rid of the young leader, as well as discredit Charles, who owed his coronation to her. In attempting to distance himself from an accused heretic and witch, the French time's pressing on a little bit here, so let's quickly have a look at some bits to do with the Black Death before we do. This is a bit of an idea of the map of Europe that we're now looking at from sort of 1360. Just after, I beg your pardon, the Black Death. So the bit we're about to read on, this is how Europe is looking. So some notable bits to look at. You've got the Duchy of Aquitaine still technically belongs to England, but doesn't really have the same powers it once had. And of course, Calais. And of course now Wales is now part of England. I believe it was also around this sort of time where Scotland had fought back against England with the famous William Wallace and Robert the Bruce. It looks like it doesn't say the Battle of Bannockburn. I think this must have followed. Succeeded by Robert the Bruce, yes. Well, anyway, this was during the 100 Years War, I believe. Or was it? You see, I've already forgotten. So this was just before the Hundred Years' War. So Scotland had been occupied by England, but they fought for their independence. That is until the crown was unified anyway. Let's go back to the map we were looking at for a moment. So we've got Ireland now, as it's, well, as it always has been, but I think there was part of Dublin that was under English control on the previous map. The Holy Roman Empire, it's taken a little more shape, a little more land, east and west, but a little less from Italy. States, which is now from its own sort of landmass next to the Kingdom of Naples. Aragon, which is I think a precursor to what a lot of people in northeastern Spain call the land of Catalonia, which is culturally different from mainland or the, you know, the mainstream Spain. Was a kingdom which included not just this area, but the islands, the Balearic Islands, Sardinia, Sicily, and part of Greece as well. Although, no, I think I might be wrong there. especially anyway, the last arm of what was once great mighty Rome, reduced to a small spit of land, about the same size as Wales, in southern Bulgaria and northwestern Turkey. Here we have Wallachia, the famous Crusades. Lovely stuff. Right, so for the last bit, let's have a look at the Black Death. So, the Black Death was a devastating global epidemic of bubonic plague that struck Europe and Asia in the mid-1300s. The plague arrived in Europe when 12 ships from the Black Sea docked at the Sicilian port of Messina. People gathered on the docks were met with a horrifying surprise. Most sailors aboard the ships were dead, and those that alive were gravely ill and covered in black boils that oozed blood and pus. Sicilian authorities hastily too late. Over the next 5 years, the Black Death would kill more than 20 million people in Europe, almost one third of the continent's population. So how did the Black Plague start? Well, even before the death ships pulled into port at Messina, many Europeans had heard rumours about a great pestilence that was carving a deadly path across the trade routes of the Near and Far East. Indeed, in the early 1340s, the disease had struck China, India, Persia, Syria, and Egypt. The plague is thought to have originated in Asia over 2,000 years ago and was likely spread by trading ships, though recent research has indicated pathogen responsible for the Black Death may have existed in Europe as early as 3000 BC. It's interesting reading about an ancient epidemic as we go through one now, but I think I know which year I prefer to have lived in, because this sounds horrific. I say that without any real exposure to COVID and its worst forms other than TV reports, but you know, some of the symptoms of the bubonic plague are just This is something that most English children or British children know from a young age, is the nursery rhyme, "A ring, a ring of roses," or "Ring around the rosy," I suppose they call it there, which was a child's nursery rhyme. Which seems innocent, but when you listen to it, "Ring around the rosy, a pocket full of posies, a tissue, we all fall down." And then children usually drop to the floor and laugh while holding their hands, after having held their hands and sung the song as they go around in circles. But listening to the lyrics of the rhyme, it's actually an analogy for the Black Death. A ring around the rosy, which was it's not got it here, but I believe "a ring around the rosy" was the meant to be a description of how the boils looked. A pocket full of posies. Those were flowers or something, some sort of remedy to help, or what they thought may be a remedy to help with the plague. I'm not sure on that one though. A tissue, but that's fairly self-explanatory. That's you sneezing or coughing, and then we all fall down. Of an imagination to understand what that one means. So it's incredible that it wiped out just so much of the population. There's so much more information on it here, and it's incredible. So it still apparently exists, and I think I heard a news report of localized incidences coming up in even the United States. So the Black Death epidemic had run its course by the early 1350s, but the plague reappeared spread like wildfire throughout parts of Northern Africa, the rest of Turkey and Georgia, Greece, Italy, much of Spain and France and southern England, and also parts of Ireland. And you can see how this, in waves, year upon year, then spread. It's incredible thinking that although this was so detrimental and deadly for the continent, how slow it was to move, considering that we have just lived through a year where, or a year and a half, where a new virus has spread around the world and, you know, affected countries multiple times already. Whereas the Black Death, as deadly as it was, took 2 years for it to get from Constantinople to, you know, parts of Romania and Hungary, which are only a few hundred miles away. I think that goes to show just how dangerous our world is now and how we have to be so prepared because of how our travel infrastructure is set up for these diseases and infections to succeed. Something else I found very interesting is that apparently this area here was unaffected by the Black Plague. So what's that? That's Poland, some Belarus, a bit of Ukraine. Fascinating. I wonder if there's people there then, through breeding, did still manage to pass on the immunity to the disease going forwards. So it's a fascinating concept. Lovely. So I think the last thing I'd like to leave on is just a little bit of art and architecture. I don't think we really did too much of that in a bit of society. This has been a very long episode, so maybe I'll break it into two chunks. So, another way to show devotion to the church was to build grand cathedrals and other ecclesiastical structures such as monasteries. And I suppose, talking about devotion, we're talking about showing it through the Crusades. Yeah, okay. Cathedrals were the largest buildings in medieval Europe. They could be found at the centre of towns and cities across the continent. Between the 10th and 13th centuries, most European cathedrals were built in the Romanesque style. Romanesque cathedrals are solid and substantial. They have rounded masonry arches and barrel vaults supporting the roof, thick stone walls, few windows. Examples of Romanesque architecture include the Porto Cathedral in Portugal and the Speyer Cathedral in present-day Germany. Let's compare these then, so let's have a look at and the second was Speyer Cathedral. So here we go. Yes. So, yeah, as you can see, very, very few windows. In fact, there are only really sort of small holes in the side, like archery holes, just letting a bit of light. And then we have Speyer Cathedral. There are holes there, but not so many windows. It's more of just an open-air cathedral. I see what they mean. It's somewhat more Romanesque, isn't it? Around 1200, church builders began to embrace a new architectural style known as the Gothic. Gothic structures, such as the Abbey Church of Saint Denis in France,
spires and flying buttresses. In contrast to heavy Romanesque buildings, Gothic architecture seems to be almost weightless. Medieval religious art took other forms as well. Frescoes and mosaics decorated church interiors, and artists painted devotional images of the Virgin Mary, Jesus, and the saints. Let's have a look at those two then, shall we? So we've got the Abbey of Saint Denis. Oh wow, yeah, look at that. Yeah. So the spires and such. Certainly some differences can be seen. Very interesting. At least I quite find that sort of thing interesting anyway. Also, before the invention of the printing press in the 15th century, even books were works of art. Craftsmen in monasteries and later in universities created illuminated manuscripts, handmade, sacred and secular books with coloured illustrations, gold and silver lettering, and other adornments. Convents were one of the few places women could receive education, and nuns wrote, translated, and illuminated manuscripts as well. In the 12th century, urban booksellers began to market smaller illuminated manuscripts, like books of hours, psalters, and other prayer books to wealthy individuals. Spanish Dominican nun, is believed to be the first woman in the Western world to earn a university degree. That's interesting. Juliana Morell. Okay, so I think we'll just round it all off. But the economics and the society that they lived in. So in medieval Europe, rural life was governed by a system scholars call feudalism. In a feudal society, the king granted large pieces of land called fiefs to noblemen and bishops. Landless peasants known as
used to live in the country, and I know I'm a bit of both. I've lived in large towns, or I'd say city, but certainly somewhere that's very built up, and I've lived in a village of fewer than 50 buildings. And a lot of the people that I met while living in the village were families that had lived there all their lives and were people that knew that life completely. And the way they looked at the world was in some ways very different, not in a bad way, and it wasn't, not trying to compare it completely to this sort of thing, as this was a completely different sort of change, but certainly these people had like TVs and they could see what was going on in the world, but their life wasn't so much about trying to please other people. It wasn't about, you know, social games, big works of art, status. It was about living happily with family, the simple life, the good life. Whereas, although I don't think this is everyone that lives in built-up areas, I think when you look at it from a comparison, it can be easy to see that when humans are, you know, when we're pushed into our bigger conurbations of living areas, or more highly densely populated areas, our life becomes much more... We become much more of a society of people who wants to be the top dog. We want to have that status. We want to have the class. You know, we're happy with a family, but we also want to have the rich cars, the nice jobs, the six-figure salaries. And I can imagine that's very much how this may have. Been similar for this sort of people, you know, in this time as well. The only people that really had money were the nobles. So if you were just any sort of commoner, even perhaps, even probably, you know, middle class, didn't really have a lot. It was only really the people that were born into it that did. So as these people moved into these great cities, the idea of the things that came with the Renaissance, a different way of living, a different society, a bit different social structure, and how that, I suppose how I see that as having shaped the modern world is very interesting. I'm sure that's something we can discuss when we learn about the Renaissance, but that will be our next episode. Anyway, this has been an incredibly long episode, so I think I may cut it into a two-parter, and hopefully that should work okay. Annoyingly, we've got the 100 Years' War taking up probably the midway point, but maybe we'll find a way of making that work. Anyway, I think I'm starting to talk to myself a little bit here. I hope, as always, this has been an enjoyable video for you and relaxing. I know that I've certainly learned a thing or two in this one. This is a period of time which I have incredible interest in. So to still be learning now, it's a great source of joy for me. But yes, let's find that looks quite nice. I think I might use that for the thumbnail. Calendar manuscript of Pietro de Crescenzi. That's a lovely picture, really nice. So I quite like that. I think we'll use that. I'll leave you on the picture that you've likely seen and started the video with. Anyway, I hope this has been a
castle.